Hi, I'm Madison from Ray Outfitted, and we're here to go through this van's electrical system and explain why trying to make a repair to the electrical requires the removal of the bed. The owners were noticing that the alternator charging wasn't working and the upfitter couldn't figure out why. And so the vehicle was brought to us to have Ray do an electrical diagnostic review. It was our first time getting to see the rig, and it brought us some concerns that we shared with the client in terms of that long-term maintenance, repairability, durability. The electrical system was built outside the vehicle, installed in the rig, and everything else went around it. Our goal is to be able to remove this, to be able to see this wiring. Ray and Ryan are gonna come in and start doing some of the disassembly so we can access this electrical system and see what's happened.
I'm Rainer from Ray Outfitted. Today we're gonna be diagnosing the electrical issues on this van. Right now we have the batteries out and we have all accessible breakers off. And right now we still have power to our charge controller for the alternator and solar power. So what we're gonna be doing is disconnecting that. What we would like to see is breakers or fuses at either end of the wire so that it can actually be disconnected for serviceability. So now that we've got the covers off, we can see what all the wires are. On this side is our solar panel and alternator charging. So first thing we'll do is disconnect the solar panel, see if that shuts down the module. If not, we'll have to disconnect the alternator charge wire. By disconnecting this, we can see that it's still live. So we're gonna just tape off this wire so it can't ground out to anything, and then take off the alternator charge wire. What I did notice when pulling off the solar wire is this module is not fully mounted. There are screw holes on the bottom that a screw should have been put in. We're removing the alternator charge wire here. And when we pull that off, we now see that everything shut down. So we know this wire is live, so we definitely have to take this off so that it doesn't short against anything.
Hi, I'm Ryan with Ray Outfitted. I do a number of things here, from building cabinets to breaking things.
That piece was supposed to keep the mattress, you know, sliding out the back, or, you know, when you're resting against the back of the bed. So it should be a little more robust.
As I'm watching them pull this out by hand, all I'm picturing is a rear end collision or a T-bone. With all of these things being loosely held, they can become projectiles in a collision. And so everything, you want it to be held secure enough that one person's brute strength isn't enough. Imagine the force of vehicles. We've had clients drive into the back of logging trucks and you get to see what wasn't secured right. And big pieces like this, you want them really secure.
I'm trying to take the sideboards off, but they're behind all the trim details for the bed. So I've got to pull off all this trim detail to be able to get this panel off now. There we go. Now, this will actually lift up.
To diagnose the electrical, the plumbing system has to come out.
Part of the plumbing system. We might be able to leave some of it. It's gonna have to be piece by piece. We're gonna have to see what has to actually be removed. Sorry. There was a screw in that one. So we've got the bed frame out. We've got access to the front section of the panel. So next thing we're gonna do is remove the bike slide, remove our two screws, and then see what else is still holding it, if anything is.
Safe.
Got it. Yeah, it doesn't look like it should be connected.
Okay. This is great. I'm lifting the whole toilet.
Well, we're trying to get the bike slide out. It was moving this whole cabinet. I went to remove this bottom drawer, but because they're undermount slides, I can't get to the releases to release this drawer. So I had to take the drawer out above it so I can get in far enough. And there's one little screw at the back here. One tiny screw, which is holding everything together.
That's gonna have to go out anyways.
Okay. So we've got our two screws out that go into the wall. We found two screws at the top here that we were able to get out normally. Now there's two screws right down at the very bottom. So I've got a 90 degree that I can actually get in here and get these two screws out. Now we can actually tilt this out and see all the wires behind it.
This is the magic moment, eh? If you wanted to repair and keep this vehicle, you needed to go
this far back
to then decide if you wanted to try to reinstall it all. Almost everything that we took out, we broke to remove it. Wow.
The customer was complaining that the alternator charging was not working. Nothing was showing up on the battery monitor. Here is the shunt for the battery monitor. You can see here there's the B negative. This is the wire that goes to the batteries. And then you've got P negative, which comes up to our bus bar. This wire here is our chassis ground. This wire was originally over here on the B negative. So it wasn't registering the chassis ground to the shunt. So anytime the engine was running, it never registered any of the battery or any of the power going into the batteries. So by moving the wire over here, we were able to correct that issue with the battery monitor. But they also have a couple other problems that we are going, that wire's also loose.
Why don't you want loose wires?
That could have been from disconnecting the batteries, but that nut should have been tighter, that I shouldn't have been able to loosen that. Loose nuts, loose wires create heat, and with creating heat creates a possibility of fire. We can see all of the wires going into the back of the fuse panel are Romex, which is solid core. RV standard says to use Romex on 120 only, and this has been used for everything. So there's 120 volt and 240 volt wiring here. There should be no 240 volt wires in this rig. All of our 12 volt wiring is solid core, which 12 volt wiring is supposed to be stranded wiring. So I just want to point out with this inverter here, we were looking at the strain reliefs, and we can see that the one strain relief right here for the AC in is actually on. The AC out, it looks like they used 240 wire in here. So it's actually got probably too many wires inside there, and they couldn't fit the strain relief on. So all they've done is just tape it in place. And then over here for the inverter controller and the temperature sensor, there's no strain relief on that. So if anything was to catch these wires, you could risk it damaging inside if they get pulled too hard. Would have been much easier if we were able to actually just swing the electrical system out of the way without having to remove the entire bed, part of the front here, remove the drawers. Just when you're building, make sure you think about the inevitable repair that will need to be done. These are vehicles and they will need repaired eventually. Just always take into account repairability while you're building stuff and make sure you have everything fused correctly. So the next thing we're going to be doing with this vehicle is we're going to be taking a look at the water system, why it was leaking. We're going to take a look through, see where all the water damage is currently and see how much further we have to disassemble the vehicle from where we are in this state, to see how far the water damage actually has gone through this van. Now that we have the electrical out, we can see this is the chassis ground wire, and you can see it's one, not tight, and two, the lug is spaced off of the metal by a washer. So all the power for the alternator charging is going through that lug, through that washer. And I've got this wire here, which probably goes up to the front. This was probably carrying a lot of the ground for the rest of the system as well. And also like that, that's a little bit of a flimsy piece of steel. Would have been nicer to see it on something a little more rigid, like maybe down here where I've got, where there's more steel. When you're doing connections, make sure you put them in a smart spot. If you've got that much wiggle in the steel, you may want to look at putting it in another spot. So we finally got these two back panels off that we couldn't get off. You can see here where the bed frame actually was that held this in. So now that this is out, here is your second bolt for the taillight. So you have one, two to remove the taillight so that you can actually change a burnt out taillight on this vehicle. This should have had an access point below the bed. So like even if this panel was like cut here or a second panel was put in, then this could have been accessible with the bed frame still in. At this point of our disassembly, we just want to give the caveat to everyone. If you are looking at building a van yourself, there's lots of information on the internet. We say make sure that you can vet whoever you are speaking to. There's lots of good places. Bluesea has a lot of stuff. Explorers.life has a lot of stuff. If you are looking to hire an upfitter, ask them what their qualifications are. Are they a home builder, an automotive mechanic, marine mechanic? Have they worked in the RV industry? And another good question is, what insurance do they have while your vehicle is in their care?